Good morning, everyone. Good morning. We're celebrating the third Sunday of Easter. I am not the celebrant of the Mass today. Yay! Our celebrant will be Father Thomas Rowlands, who was ordained last Saturday. This is his first public Mass, and at the same time in Wilton Manors, Father Saul is saying his first Mass at 11 o'clock, and in Washington, D.C., I call her Father Colleen, will be saying her Mass for her first public Mass today.
my weakness and my occasional cowardice, I still want to say that I believe in you and I love you. I know you keep loving me, and I want to keep loving you.
Indeed, the Lord keeps us, forgiving us, and we ask him to restore us fully in his love. Lord Jesus, you bring us the joy of forgiveness. I want to love you for your mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Jesus Christ, you have given us life. I thank you for it, and I love you. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are our companion in life. Stay with me, for I love you. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Have mercy and forgive us, Lord. Make us grow in love of you and of people. Lead us to the joy of everlasting life.
Amen. God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Glory God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth.
Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer.
Glory to God in the highest.
God than people. The God of our ancestors has raised Jesus,
whom you put to death by hanging him on a tree. This one, who has been exalted to God's right hand as ruler and Savior, is to bring repentance and the forgiveness of sins to Israel. We are witnesses to this, and so is the Holy Spirit, who has been given to those who obey God. The Sanhedrin flogged the apostles. After warning them not to speak again in the name of Jesus, they dismissed them. The apostles left the Sanhedrin full of joy that they had been judged worthy to suffer shame for the sake of the name. This is the word of God. In all creation, Christ.
again was manifested to the disciples at Lake Tiberias. This is how the appearance took place. Assembled were Simon Peter, Thomas the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, Zebedee's children, and two other disciples. Peter said to them, "I'm going out to fish." "We will join you," they replied, and went off to get into their boat. All through the night, they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus was standing on the shore, though none of the disciples knew that it was Jesus. He said to them, "Have you caught anything, friends?" "Not a thing," they answered. "Cast your net off to the starboard side, and you will find something." So they made a cast and caught so many fish, they could not haul the net in. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved cried out to Peter, "It is the teacher." Upon hearing this, Simon Peter threw on his cloak, he was naked, and jumped into the water. Meanwhile, the other disciples brought the boat to shore, towing the net full of fish. They were not far from the land, no more than, say, 100 yards. When they landed, they saw that a charcoal fire had been prepared with fish and some bread being grilled. "Bring some of the fish you just caught," Jesus told them. Simon Peter went aboard and hauled ashore the net, which was loaded with huge fish, 153 of them. In spite of the great number, the net wasn't torn. "Come and eat your meal," Jesus told them. None of the disciples dared to ask, "Who are you?" They knew it. They knew that it was the Savior. Jesus came over, took the bread, gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This marked the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after being raised from the dead. When they had eaten their meal, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me, friend?" Jesus said, "Tend my sheep." A second time, Jesus put his question to Simon, the daughter of John, "Do you love me?" Peter said, "Yes, Rabbi, you know that I am your friend." Jesus replied, "Tend my sheep." A third time Jesus asked him, "Simon, begot of John, do you love me as a friend, Lord?" Peter was hurt that Jesus asked again, "Do you love me?" for a third time. So he said, "You know everything, Rabbi. You know that I am your friend." Then Jesus said, "Feed my sheep." The truth of the matter is, when you were young, you put on your own belt and walked where you liked. But as you get old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will put the belt around you and take you where you want to go. With these words, Jesus indicated the sort of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then Jesus said, "Follow me." The good news of salvation.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Now, Jesus fills our emptiness. In the gospel we just read, the boat was empty. Something was missing. They set out without Jesus. Isn't that sometimes the case with all of us? We want to trust in ourselves. We don't want to have to rely on God. And at the same time, deep down, we really do want to rely on God. We want to know that someone is in charge, that all these wayward paths convert. The apostles did exactly that. They go fishing, but they're fishing without the Lord. And so they don't catch anything. Sometimes God allows us best laid plans to come crashing down around us. How many times has that happened? He doesn't do this to torment us, but to teach us to trust in Him. Their embarrassment and frustration must have been pretty overwhelming. The fishermen tend to be fairly proud of their skill set. And when they're stuck, it's humiliating. And then to make matters worse, Jesus shows up on the shore and asks, "Have you caught anything?" This is like rubbing salt, you know. And you can imagine the way they growled in response. "No, we haven't caught anything." How many times has that happened to you when you were questioning? And they must have been thinking to themselves, "And mind your own business." But the apostles needed to recognize their own weaknesses. They needed to vocalize their own inability to do anything without Jesus. And when they do that, He acts. He fills the boat with 153 types of fish. According to St. Jerome, there are 153 types of fish in the ocean. So that number represents above all the fullness of the church. But it also represents the fulfillment in our own lives when we give them over to Christ. He fills our emptiness with His friendship. He gives us meaning and purpose. He fills our lives with wonder. He fills our lives with love. Brother Andrew, from the Missionary Brothers of Charity, tells us the following story. One day, Mother Teresa received a letter written by a man on the day of his intended suicide. He wrote that on the preceding afternoon, he had worked out all the details for what seemed to be him a perfectly rational suicide. And then, quite by accident, he came across Alfred Mugridge's biography of St. Mother Teresa. And bored with nothing else to do, he started to read it. He said, as he read, he found that the book, or rather that life, giving him a new interest in life. And as he finished it, he moved back from the brink of suicide to begin life anew. The example of Mother Teresa, until then unknown to him and given him hope, this man had discovered that his boat was empty. But by the example of a living saint, he realized that it could be full. Give, and you will receive. How many times have we heard that? When we feel empty, the tendency is to close in on ourselves. But that's a huge mistake. Just like the apostle, we're tempted to return to our comfort zone. There's the fishing. What's mine? Food? Or shopping, or ESPN, or wine, where do we turn? We're familiar with them all. We all is to give ourselves to others. Break out of that protective shell and give. How do we do that? Here are a few suggestions. Let's pick one of them, or something else that comes to mind during the Mass, and work on it this week. Visit someone who's alone. I'm sure we know a few of those. Or at least call them. Invite a friend to come to Mass sometime. Say a prayer for someone who's suffering. Resolve to do 3 acts for your spouse, or kids, or sibling, or co-worker. It could be simple. Simple hello. Thank you. We're in the middle of the Easter season. Jesus wants to fill our hearts, everyone, with joy, with the joy of His presence. As we serve Him and others, we begin to experience that joy more and more. When we receive Christ today, really present in the Eucharist, we ask Him to help us to give ourselves to others. And we trust that through Him, with Him, and in Him, what seems empty can be truly full. Food for thought for today. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, you got to know you're doing it, and you're doing it willingly and all. Does that fit the MO, if you will, of summer committee suicide? Absolutely not. So then the church turned around and said, okay, you can bring them in for the funeral. Because they didn't really commit a sin. You see again where man gets involved and it screws everything up. So, you know, Christ is asking each of us, do you love me? And what's our answer then? You know, is it a rote answer? Or is it try to seek unity in you to become your flock, with you as our one shepherd. And so we pray.
Lord, let your love grow in us.
Lord, we ask parents today, do you love me? Let them answer yes. Lord, we love you. For we let our children recognize you in our care and loving concern. And so we say,
Lord, let your love grow in us.
Lord, you ask those who suffer, do you love me? Let them answer, yes, Lord, we love you. For we recognize you in good people who help us in your name. And so we say,
Lord, let your love grow in us.
Lord, you ask our communities today, do you love me? Make us answer wholeheartedly, yes, Lord, we love you. For we have open and welcoming you in the least among us. We try our best to become one heart and one soul. And so we pray.
Lord, let your love grow in us.
What other intentions do we have today?
I don't want to sound selfish, but I ask everybody to please pray for me. Because I'm so much struggling with the memory of that day when my stepmother passed.
Give us the power and courage to love you very deeply, in yourself and in one another, now and forever.
Amen.
If you would go to the song sheet that you have, that will be our offertory.
Thank you.
he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world. By his death, he destroyed death, and by his resurrection, he created life anew. Therefore, in this season, all the world rejoices in the Paschal joy. Therefore, in the company of heaven and the choirs of angels magnify you, singing the praise of your glory.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power, God of might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
We praise you, Creator in heaven, in this night of joy in this Eastertide. To rescue us from the power of darkness, you did not abandon your Son in death. In him, we have received freedom, the forgiveness of sins, the abundance of new life. Send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts that we live in them, we may have to share in the fullness of life, your beloved Son. Make us witnesses to all your love and to in the fellowship of your table. On the night before he suffered, he took the bread, spoke the blessing, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying,
"Take this, all of you,
and eat it.
This is my body,
which will be given up for you." After the supper, he took the cup of wine, thanked you again, and gave you thanks. Gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me." As often as we do, as we eat this bread and drink from this cup, we taste and proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
In this way we celebrate Easter, the suffering and death of your Son, the new life which you have given him. He, the firstborn from the dead, exalted to the right hand, intercedes for us. He will come again in glory to give us the fullness of life. We bring bread and wine before you, the signs to which he himself has given the promise of his presence. Raise your church to new life and rescue it from the powers of death, from the death of fear, of incorruptible life.